So it's a pleasure to have all of you here, and a particular pleasure to welcome our honored guest, Robert Greene. You're all here, so I think you probably know a lot about his books, his writings. I'll say just a few words. He's trained in classical literature, and then had a very shifting career for some early period of his post-college life, and then settled in to write a series of extremely fascinating books that draw on his classical training and the readings that he did, that looks at the lives and writings of a number of the major figures in the Western and Eastern canon. He's written about power, about seduction, about war. And with that background, of course, it's not surprising that he also made a wonderful connection with the hip-hop crowd, became a guru of them for a while, set up a collaboration with them. We were talking beforehand. It's clear that he enjoyed that collaboration, and it's not bad to be a guru from what he said. But it also achieved some of his other aims about who he was hoping to help empower. And I thought what we'd do is, after we give him a big applause for welcome, ask him to say a bit about himself and what he's working on, and then we'll open it up for questions. But why don't we start with giving him a nice warm welcome.
Is it better if I stand or if I sit, or what's the protocol?
Whatever's comfortable. It's informal, you're welcome.
Well, I come from Los Angeles. I was actually born in Los Angeles, and I don't mean to disparage California or Los Angeles, particularly, or any other people from there, but I will say that the IQ levels in a place like that are generally a little bit lower than you find here. So I'm actually a little bit intimidated by all of these very smart people here. So I'm a little bit nervous, I hope you understand. Basically, I started writing back in 1996. I've been writing my whole life. But I met somebody who, we were in Italy together at the same time working on a project. And it was a really awful Machiavellian environment in Italy, if you can imagine that. And all of these terrible political games being played. And we were just miserable and depressed. It was actually 95. And he was a book packager, and he asked me if I had any ideas for books. And all of this pain that I had been through in the work world with all of these political conniving figures, it just came up out of me, and it was a beautiful day in Venice, Italy, and I sort of improvised this idea for a book, and he loved it, and he basically paid me to live while I wrote the 48 Laws of Power, and that's where it started. So for 15, 16 years, I've had this sort of weird position in life that I don't know how many other people have had, where I've been able to devote all of my attention to studying what I consider to be the most kind of powerful, charismatic, successful Machiavellian characters in history and contemporary figures like 50. So I may not be good at many things. I can't build things with my hands or anything like that, but I have this one expertise. Why some people excel, why some people are superior in the political game or in their creativity or whatever it is. And so, in figuring out what I wanted to talk to you about today, and I was talking with Casper, who I want to thank for helping to organize this, there's a sort of a philosophy that all of these figures that I've studied, that they all share. And you know, I'm often asked, like, you know, people say, well, I want to become powerful. What's the secret to it? And I don't believe in that kind of glib four-sentence or one-book answer about how to be powerful. But there is an attitude towards life, a way of looking at things, a way of thinking that all of these people that I've been studying, they all share this kind of way of looking at the world. It's what I call radical realism. And the reason I call it radical is realism has this sort of idea of just sort of understanding the world, and it sort of has a cynical, sometimes an edge to it. And I want the idea of really deeply understanding what life is about, how people operate in this world, and not only being realistic and understanding it, but accepting in a very deep way that this is what the world is like, and actually loving it and embracing it and working with reality. And all of these figures, from 50 Cent to Napoleon Bonaparte to Cleopatra to John F. Kennedy, I believe they all share this kind of attitude. So I'm going to talk, hopefully not too long, because I really want to get to your questions, and I encourage you to barrage me with all kinds of difficult questions. I want to talk about three aspects of this attitude. The first is what I call Machiavellian realism, or the Machiavellian reality. The second is existential reality, what it really means to be a human being. And the third is what I call aesthetic realism. And my idea is that to the degree that you accept these realities in life, you're going to be successful and powerful. And to the degree that you deny them and you avoid them and you hate them and you're miserable about them and you try and run away, you're not going to have success in life. And so the first one, as I said, is what I call our Machiavellian reality. And there's a concept that's lately kind of fascinates me that I've been using for my next book. And it's a term called Machiavellian intelligence. And it's something that came about in the 60s and 70s, where various scientists, people studying the brain, they're trying to understand why is it that the human brain is so much larger than anything else we have in nature. How did this happen? Why did our brains develop in this way so rapidly and become so much more complex than any other animal on the planet? And they basically went back to primates, unless you believe in creationism, our ancestors. And basically, primates are the other animal that have this exceptionally large brain, a brain that seems to be in excess of their needs. And to explain why our brains developed in this way, they looked at primates, and they came up with a really fascinating theory called Machiavellian intelligence. And the gist of it is the following. What makes primates different from any other animal is that they live in very complex social environments. There are other animals like wolves, etc., that live in packs, that have hierarchies, the alpha male, etc. But primates, I'm talking about chimps, baboons, orangutans, that whole group, have a much deeper, a much more complex social organization. They have rituals of grooming, where they groom each other for hours upon hours during the day, forming all kinds of friendships and alliances. They remember these friendships and these alliances over the space of 10, 20 years. The other thing that primates have that's so bizarre and interesting is that they're the only animal we know that practice deception, games of manipulation among each other. There is no other animal on the planet that we can say that about. And so they label primates as the Machiavellian creature, the Machiavellian animal. And they've shown colonies of monkeys, for instance, in Puerto Rico, where they do a lot of studies, incredible games of manipulation that are going on among these little small communities. And one of the discoveries that they have in looking at these primates is that they possess a power that is known as the theory of mind. Now, I don't know if you are familiar with this concept, but basically it's the idea that only humans or primates have a concept where I can think about perhaps what is going on in your mind right now. Most animals can only judge another creature based on its outward behavior, about what they're doing, about the threat that they perhaps represent. But a human and a primate has the capacity to actually literally imagine what is it that I'm pointing to you. because I'm thinking about you right there. What is it exactly that is going on in your brain right now? What are you thinking? What are you thinking right now? Now, they've discovered that primates actually possess this theory of mind. It's related to something called mirror neurons. I'm not going to get too technical with you here. I'm not a neuroscientist myself, but basically mirror neurons is this fascinating phenomenon where if I pick up this my cell phone, they can look on a map of my brain and see that certain neurons are firing when I actually pick up this phone. If I watch him pick up the phone, the same neurons are firing. It's called mirror neurons. And so basically, this allows me to learn by imitation. I can experience what you're doing with picking up that phone as if I almost myself were feeling that. This allows humans and primates to understand and to put themselves in the mind of another person. This allows for all kinds of complicated social behavior. It allows for us to be empathetic creatures, to cooperate, but it also allows for very deep levels of deception, manipulation, con games, whatever you want to call it. Because the moment I know what you're thinking, or I can imagine what your intentions are, I can strategize, I can play all kinds of games, I can try and distract you, deceive you, etc. So they've shown, they've shown that monkeys, for instance, possess these mirror neurons, that chimpanzees possess this ability of theory of mind, and from all of this stems all of this incredible Machiavellian behavior. And so the theory, to bring this all back to it, of Machiavellian intelligence is that the reason primate brains develop so rapidly is in dealing with this very complicated social environment. An animal normally is only dealing with its physical environment, but primates are dealing with their social environment, and it's in dealing with the social problems, in dealing with fellow chimpanzees and what they are thinking, that the brain had to develop very rapidly in a very small period of time. Primates started evolving, modern primates as we know them, 40 million years ago. Some 6 million years ago, we humans diverged from that, and we had the first, what is known as Homo erectus. And our earliest ancestors have this inheritance in them, this Machiavellian intelligence. And we formed larger and larger groupings. We were the first animal that actually hunted big game, and in creating, being able to hunt something like that, involved all kinds of complicated organization. So if you map out very rapidly, and I'm skipping over millions of years of history, and somebody, a historian would be very offended by how I'm doing this, but you would see an incredible increase in this social complexity over millions of years leading up to a modern era where a person who is raised as a human being in our environment is not simply dealing with a group of 20 people and having to figure out how to navigate in that world, but you're talking about people, us, who have to deal with thousands upon thousands of people living in communities, in our workplace, in politics, in government, in business. All of the deep levels of manipulation, deception, cooperation, that whole element that goes into what is known as Machiavellian intelligence. And so through this concept, the idea is that we humans, the reason why we've evolved so rapidly, why we are so clever, why we are so smart, is that we are inherently social creatures. That you can't divorce the games that we have to play, what we have to learn in how to get along with other people. You can't divorce that from our other forms of intelligence. This is very much who we are. We are, by our nature, the Machiavellian animal. It is 40 million years of evolution starting from primates back back then to who we are now. There's no way to deny that. There's no way to, in the course of 20 years or 80 years, to evolve beyond it. It's who we are. And so this is my definition of that first sort of basic reality, what I call our social reality or the Machiavellian reality. Now, there's nobody out there who really talks about this. There are not many books written about it. There's nobody here at Yale teaching a class on how to be Machiavellian in the world or how to handle that kind of environment, at least as far as I know. When you enter the real world, you're suddenly blindsided by this whole realm that exists. It's like our dirty little secret. People will talk about their sex lives. You'll get Dr. Ruth here. We'll go through all of that. But nobody talks about all of those power games that are constantly going on in the world. So I just wanted to interject into this idea my own personal story when I got out of college and I suddenly was confronted with this real world. I had graduated, as he mentioned, in the classical background, and I was immersed in studying philosophy and literature and languages. And so when I started working in, essentially in magazines, I worked at Esquire magazine and a few others, I had no idea of how the things operated in the real world, and I was very much shocked by all of the egos and the insecurities and the game playing and the political stuff. It really kind of disturbed me and it upset me. And I can remember when I was about 26 or 27 years old, one particular job that was kind of the turning point in my life. I'm not going to tell you which job this was. I don't want you Googling it and figuring out who I'm talking about. But basically the job was I had to find stories that would then be put into either film or a magazine, whatever. But I was judged on how many good stories I found. And so in this job, I actually thought I'm a very competitive person, and I was doing better than anybody else there. I was finding more stories that ended up getting produced because I felt that's the point. You're trying to produce. You're trying to get work done. Isn't that the most important thing? Isn't that why we're all here? And suddenly I found that my superior, this woman, whose name I won't mention, made it very clear that she wasn't happy with me, that something was wrong. I was doing something wrong, and I couldn't figure out what it was. And so going on what I was mentioning, that theory of mind, this power that we have, I sort of put myself in her shoes, and I'm thinking, what is it that I'm doing that's displeasing her? I'm clearly producing. And I figured out, well, maybe it's because I'm not involving her in what I'm in my ideas. I need to run them by her. I need to make it, you know, involve her more so she feels like she's a part of the research that I'm doing. So I would go into her office and I would tell her where my ideas were coming. I was trying to engage with her, figuring that was the problem. Well, that didn't seem to work. She was still clearly unhappy with me, maybe didn't like me. So I thought, going further, well, maybe I'm not being friendly enough with her. Maybe I need to be nice to her. Maybe I need to go in and not talk about work, but just be nice and talk like a human being. Okay, so that was strategy number two. I started doing that. Still didn't have any effect. She still seemed really cold and kind of mean. I figured, all right, she just hates me. That's just life. You can't, not everybody can love you. That's just it. I mean, what the hell? I'll just do my job. Then one day we're having a meeting in which we're discussing our ideas, and she suddenly erupts. She says, "Robert, you have an attitude problem." I go, "What? You're not listening to people here." "I'm listening, but I mean, isn't, you know, I produce, I do my work. What, you're going to judge me about how wide my eyes are open and how I'm listening to people?" And she says, "No, you have a problem here." "I'm sorry, I don't think I do." Anyway, over the course of the next few weeks, she just started kind of torturing me about this idea that I had an attitude. And of course, naturally, I developed an attitude. I started resenting her, and a couple weeks later, I quit because I hated it. I probably quit a week before they were going to fire me anyway. And I went home, and over the course of several weeks, I thought really deeply about this. What what happened here? What did I do wrong? I mean, you know, she just didn't like me. I think I'm a likable person. And I figured, I came to this conclusion. I had violated a law of power 12 years before I ever wrote the book. Law number one, never outshine the master. I had gone into this environment thinking that what mattered was doing a great job and showing how talented I was. But in doing that, I had made this woman, my superior, insecure that maybe I was after her job or that maybe I was better than she was. And I would make her look bad because the great ideas were coming from me, not from her. And I had violated law number one. And when you violate law number one, you're going to suffer for it because you're touching on a person's ego and their insecurity. And that's the worst thing you can do. And that's what had happened. So in reflecting over this, it was kind of the turning point in my life. And I said, I'm never going to let this happen again. I'm never going to get emotional, because that's what happened. I basically reacted emotionally to her torturing me and developed an attitude. I'm never going to let that happen again. I don't care. I'm a writer. I don't care about these jobs that I get. I'm just going to become a master observer of the game of power. I'm going to watch these people as if they were mice in a laboratory. With some distance. And I developed a motto that I still use to this day. And that motto is, it's all material. Everything that happens is material. Material for a book, material for a novel, for a screenplay. I want to be the master observer of this world. And this suddenly allowed me now to not only observe the power games going on in the many different kinds of jobs that I've had, and I can tell you I've had jobs from working in journalism, I worked in a detective agency, I worked for music producer, I worked for film, everything possible. In having this distance and looking at the world like this, suddenly I had power. I wasn't emotionally involved, I had some distance, and I could deal with things. And from that, I developed the 48 Laws of Power when I was finally given the opportunity to write the book. And so what I decided in the 48 Laws, and has since is very much a part of me, is that if this is the reality that we must all deal with, that we are social creatures, that we live in environments where there are all kinds of complicated networks, we are in a way defined by how we handle this reality. And there are three types of people in this world in dealing with this social reality. There are what I call the deniers, the people who deny this reality exists. They almost want to pretend that we're descended from angels and not from primates, that what I'm talking about here is cynical, it doesn't really exist, it doesn't happen. Among these deniers, you'll find two types. You'll find people who are genuinely disturbed by the politicking aspect of human nature, and they don't want any kind of job in which they have to do that. And so you'll find that they are slowly marginalized, and they can be happy that way, and they're never going to assume a position of great responsibility because it involves all of this. The other branch of the deniers are the people that are the passive aggressors. I would classify this woman who had tortured me as a kind of a classic passive aggressor. People who consciously don't want to admit that there's any kind of manipulation going involved, but unconsciously are playing all kinds of games. And in my books, I often describe the many different kinds. They're the trickiest kind of person to deal with, the passive aggressors. The second type of person, besides the deniers, are those who love this Machiavellian part of our nature and revel in it and are master manipulators and con artists and connivers and are very aggressive, and they have no problem handling this part. In fact, they love it. This type of person, which is very, you know, usually you'll find one or two in an office or an environment, they can get pretty far, but eventually they're tripped up in life because they're too Machiavellian. They don't understand that there's the other side to that whole idea of theory of mind and the mirror neurons, which is empathy and cooperation and getting other people and seducing people and getting them to work with you. They're too much involved with themselves and their own ego, and they love manipulating until they go too far and they have a fall in life, and there's like a wall, they can never get past it. The third type is what I'm calling the radical realist. It's what I'm proposing that you adopt. And it goes as follows. This is our nature. This is how we evolved over millions of years. There's no point in denying it. It's who we are. And not only am I not going to deny it, I'm going to accept that this is the human being as it has evolved over all of this time. And in fact, I love it. It's fine. There's nothing wrong with the fact that in this world people are playing political games. There's nothing wrong with the fact that there are seducers and con artists and it's going on all the time. It's just reality. It's just the world as it is. Stop fighting it. Just accept it. Within that accepting of it, it's not that you love it and want to go out in the world and play all these nasty games. It's that you understand they exist. If occasionally you have to do them, fine, that's okay within reason. If it's often other people are practicing against you, which you'll find a lot in your life once you leave the confines of Yale, that's okay. You understand the laws of power. You understand what people are up to, and they can't necessarily hurt you. In accepting this reality and in dealing with it and in studying human nature and this aspect of what I call Machiavellian intelligence, suddenly with that attitude, with that mentality, you have all kinds of power and freedom. Ever since I wrote my books and they've been published, I do all kinds of consulting work with business leaders, political figures, artists, very powerful people. Most of them are absolutely brilliant. They're brilliant at the technical side of their business. They figured out how to make a lot of money. They figured out how to maybe win elections or how to create a kind of music, et cetera, and market it. But they inevitably come to me for advice because they have a blind spot. They don't understand the human nature, the political games that are going on. They don't understand why somebody who they groomed as a successor, who they brought off the streets and helped and gave money to and developed, is suddenly turning against them and betraying them in a very overt manner. It's because they've spent their whole lives studying the technical side of their field, and they haven't spent any time observing other people. They haven't spent any time understanding human nature and why some people have egos and why and how that kind of ego will operate in an environment like an office. And it's because, excuse me, and this is the part of the game that trips up most people. And all I'm trying to say is that in accepting it and in studying it and making and opening your eyes to this reality, you're going to suddenly find yourself that there's a whole other realm of life that you're not observing, that you're not paying attention to. And if you pay attention to it, suddenly the whole power game, the whole dynamic will alter in your favor. The second reality I want to talk about is in context of my work with 50 Cent. A few years ago, I was contacted by 50, Curtis Jackson, and out of the blue, he was a big fan of the 48 Laws of Power. And I had known that, you know, there was something going on in the hip-hop world, like Jay-Z had been quoting the book, and Nas had quoted one of the songs and lyrics. So something was happening. But 50 wanted to meet me. I had no idea, but I was excited by that. So we met, and we kind of hit it off in a very weird way. You know, you can't imagine two people from two more different backgrounds in the world than he and I. But there was something about us that really clicked. So we decided, based on this, to do a book together. And I decided, after meeting him and spending some time with him, that this guy is really different. Now, I live in Los Angeles. I'm not somebody who's generally starstruck. I'm not interested in celebrities. They bore me. They don't interest me. So it wasn't a celebrity thing. There was something about him that was really interesting. He's really different. He had a kind of calmness. He had a charisma. He had power. So I wanted to figure out what made him different. Why is he like this? So maybe we could learn something from him, and I would express that in the book. So we would spend a long time talking about his life. And in talking about his life, I sort of began to see a pattern. So I don't know how familiar you are with this, but at the age of about 9 years old, he started hustling on the streets in Southside, Queens, dealing drugs. He did that because he realized that school was a complete dead end for somebody from his background, that only suckers went into school. The schools were really bad. They led to really bad jobs. The only people he could see in the hood that had power were the hustlers, so he was going to become a great hustler. And 9 years old is kind of early to start hustling, but that's when he was doing it. So he was sitting there hustling on the streets. And soon he discovered that hustling wasn't what he thought it was. It was actually quite boring. Day after day, at 6 o'clock in the morning, you had to stand on the street corner. Nothing would happen. You just had to think about whatever. You had no books, nothing to read, no music, nothing to listen to. Just waiting for people to buy your drugs. It was so boring, and it wasn't glamorous at all. And on top of that, it was a trap. Hustlers don't get out of their life. You know, most of them die by the time. Very few of them live past the age of 25, or they're in prison for most of their lives. To think that you're going to succeed in hustling is an illusion. There's a limit to it. So I'm going to get out. And about at the age of 15, which is also a bit precocious, he decided he was going to get out of hustling, and he was going to become the only other thing he could think you could become, which was a rapper. So now he started learning how to rap, and he met Jam Master Jay, and he sort of apprenticed with him, and he started getting reasonably successful, and he had record labels interested in him. And then he realized that this was yet another kind of trap. The trap was that the record label kind of owned you, and they would develop artists very quickly, and then get rid of them as soon as they were not so hot anymore. So you usually had like a couple of years of power and success, and then it all faded, and you were miserable, and then you went back to drugs or dealing or whatever. That it was almost worse than being a hustler, being a rapper. That to have power in that world was extremely difficult. And he got fed up with it. And he decided to leave it. And he decided he was going to go back into hustling. And he went back into hustling. This is about when he's about 18. Maybe 19, I don't remember exactly. And that's when he got shot. I'm sure you all know the story. From a beef that was going on, an old beef. Somebody came up to him while he was sitting in the back seat of a car and shot 9 times to a few feet away from him. One of the bullets like went right through his mouth. And he miraculously survived that. And it was coming out of that experience that he had his own kind of turning point in life. And he determined after that that he was not going to give up. He was not going to get depressed. He was not going to go back into hustling. He was going to launch his music career, but he was going to do it all on his own, all by himself. He was going to launch a kind of mixtape campaign on the streets of New York like no one had ever seen before. Because he didn't have a record label, he was going to be able to be as nasty and violent and tell all kinds of stories, the reality of the streets, because there was nobody there who was going to censor him and say, oh, we can't get that on the radio, we don't want you to say this or that. Fuck all that, I'm going to say exactly what I want, and I'm going to put it out on these mixtapes. I'm going to create a hard sound that's going to be kind of reflect the violence that I've known my whole life. And I'm going to do everything myself. I'm going to package it. I'm going to do my own artwork. I'm going to mix it myself. I'm going to have a group of people around me, but I'm not going to depend on any record label. And he did that with such energy and such drive and such love for it that after 2 years of this campaign, Eminem got one of his mixtapes and thought this was the greatest thing he had ever heard, and he signed 50 to his record label at Interscope, and then, you know, the rest is history. And so when I was looking at this, the pattern that I saw was that this was somebody that refused to be dependent on other people. He refused to go for the usual traps in life. In this case, hustling on the streets or being a rapper with a good label. He was supremely realistic. He saw through all the bullshit that the world put at you, and he saw, this is where the power lies in life. I'm going to go towards it. And I was thinking, why would somebody like this be so realistic, so pragmatic, and so sharp in his thinking, when a lot of his peers were not like that? A lot of his peers got totally seduced by the idea of becoming a great hustler. And I determined it's because of his very unusual background. 50 never knew his father. To this day, he doesn't know who his father was. His mother was murdered when he was 8 years old. He was lived with his grandparents, but basically he was alone. He had no peers. He had no adult supervision. He was basically thrown out onto the... You need to get that? He was basically thrown out onto the streets of Queens with nobody, nothing. No protection, no parental support. But on the other hand, which we would almost assume is a very negative thing, on the other hand, he had nobody telling him who he should be, what he should do, what defines him. He had to do everything himself. He had to decide who he was, who he wanted to be, without the usual crutches that most of us have. And I determined that, in fact, this reality of his, this what I call his existential reality, that he was basically alone in the world and had to do things for himself and define who he wanted to be, that that's actually the reality of each and every one of us. But we're not aware of it. We have the illusion that parents, that friends, that all of our support network is going to help us out in the end, that we can define ourselves through other people, by conforming to a group, by being like other people, by doing what other people tell us to do. But that is actually the illusion. That's actually the con game that goes on. The truth is, you are essentially alone in life. You were born alone, and you're going to die alone. And although you have these networks of support, and they are real, and you do have parents, on the other hand, it is really up to you to define who you are and what you want in life. And that what 50 had, and that what most really powerful people have in life, is a sense that they are unique, that there is something very different about them. And to the extent that you bring out your uniqueness in life, that you become more of an individual, that you bring more of your individuality into play, the more power you're going to have. By refusing to be a hustler like everybody else, by refusing to be the typical rapper on a label, by going out there and saying, I don't care about all that, I'm going to create the music that reflects my reality, he stood out from everybody else, and he gained power. Now, I talked about this once a few months ago. I was invited to Stanford University to give a little talk, and I was explaining this idea of uniqueness, essentially saying that each and every human being that's ever born, there's never going to be another you ever in the history of the universe. And it's an actually remarkable thought that your DNA, it will never be repeated, ever in the past, ever in the future. It is completely different. You and your experiences in your life, there will never be anybody else like you. And that you are truly born as an individual, but that you're spending your life running away from it. I gave this talk, and it was a group of people that I don't think were very receptive to this talk. And afterwards, this Italian woman came up to me, and she said, you know, Robert, you're talking about an individual. It is so American. It is so American. This whole thing about the cowboy and Ronald Reagan and being an individual. You know, that's not how we are in Europe. I'm doing a bad job for accents. That's not how we are, you know. For us, that these things aren't important. It's just so American. And then she proceeded to tell me about her grandfather, who was a truck driver in Italy, and how he loved his life as a truck driver, and he was happy as that. And she was saying, what's wrong with that? Why can't people just accept that kind of, if that's what their role in life is? Why do you have to be always striving for something else? And my answer to her, which I will abbreviate, was basically, first of all, how do you know that your grandfather was happy as a truck driver? Usually people, when they're in their 20s or a little bit younger, have a dream about life, an ambition. They want something. And maybe he settled for being a truck driver, and maybe he accepted it. But how do you know deep down inside that that was really what he wanted? You're assuming something. But even let's just pretend that he was happy being a truck driver. You're talking about the 1950s. You're living in a Rossellini neo-realistic movie from the 1950s in which people had a union, and there was communism and left-wing activity, and being a truck driver meant something else that it doesn't mean anymore. That truck driver in Italy in the year 2010 is dealing with a globalized environment, the withering away of the welfare state, and is facing all kinds of conflicts and problems, and they're not happy. They're not necessarily happy. That the world that as we're evolving right now is becoming completely different from the world of 50, 60 years ago, where someone like my father would work for one company his whole life and felt protected by them. That's gone. You no longer can depend on anybody and any job or your boss protecting you. We're all dealing with a world that's so much more insecure, where we have to learn these self-reliant skills, where putting out our individuality is the only way we're going to get power in this world. That you're dealing with an environment that is long gone. Whether that's good or bad, I don't know. And that the reality that we're all facing is that we're left on our own, and we have to develop these self-reliant skills, and we have to not be afraid of expressing our individuality. In the book that I'm writing now, I can talk about it later if you like, I'm interviewing 8 of the most eminent people in the world today in different fields, in neuroscience, in architecture, in music. All of them are inherently nonconformists. All of them are inherently bucking the trend and taking their field in a completely novel direction by bringing out more of that uniqueness that I was talking about. I realize I've come a little bit longer than I wanted to do on this subject, so I'm not even going to get to my third reality because I want to give you enough time to ask questions. But I wanted to give you an idea of this kind of overall philosophy that is sort of brings all of my books together, and that I'm actually chapter 1 in the 50th law. If you've read it, goes very deeply into the subject of realism, and I'm going to be going deeper into it into my next book. But I've kind of hit my own wall here. I've bonked, so I want to open up this now to your questions.